Hi everyone. So in the previous presentation, we have been discussed about what is biopharmaceutics, the various definitions, and about absorption, the plasma concentration depth profile, and hope you got a clear idea about that content. And to the continuation of the previous session, now we are going to discuss about mechanism of absorption. So a drug to get penetrate or move through this membrane to the another part. So here, what are the various mechanism involved in it? So from the gastrointestinal lumen to the blood. So what are the various mechanism involved? That's what we are going to discuss in this presentation. So with this, let us move on to the next slide. So the mechanism of absorption, there are three broad categories of absorption. The first one is transcellular or intracellular transport. So under this transcellular or intracellular transport, the first one is passive transport process. In this passive transport process, we have few types. The first is passive diffusion, the second is pore transport, and the third is ion pair transport, the fourth is facilitated diffusion. So in the transcellular or intracellular transport, the second aspect is active transport process. So under this active transport process, we have a primary and secondary aspects. So in this secondary, we will be discussing about what is symport or co-transporter and what is antiport or counter transport. So continuation to this classification, next to the transcellular, we will be discussing about paracellular or intercellular transport. So in this paracellular intercellular transport, we will be discussing about permeation through the tight junction of epithelial cells, also about resorption. And the last thing which we will be discussing under this mechanism of absorption is vesicular or corpuscular transport, which is commonly called as endocytosis. And the types which comes under this are pinocytosis and phagocytosis. So in this presentation, we are going to know about all these aspects one by one in detail. Let's move on to the next slide. So, passive diffusion. So passive diffusion is also known as a non-ionic diffusion. So almost 90% of the drug undergoes this passive diffusion. So this passive diffusion plays a major role in drug mechanism, and this concentration gradient as well as electrochemical gradient act as a main principle in passive diffusion. If a drug get moves from higher concentration to lower concentration, that we call it as a concentration gradient movement. So this generally takes place in osmosis or diffusion. So movement of a molecule from a high concentration to low concentration. So initially, in one side of a membrane, we may have or come across with the higher concentration of drug. So opposite side, where there will be no concentration. So initially, the movement of drug will be very rapid from the concentration area, higher concentration area, to the lower concentration. And the transportation of this molecule takes place until the achievement of equilibrium. So once the equilibrium is achieved, the process of transportation from one side to another side will be getting stopped off. So this is what a passive diffusion is. It doesn't need any energy. So it works itself with the help of the, without using any energy. So in this, we have a process of passive diffusion. As a drug, initially it presents in aqueous solution at the absorption site. So the drug will be in hydrophobic, hydrophilic in nature. in the absorption site, it will be in aqueous solution. And once it reaches the membrane, there it gets partitioned and dissolved in the liquid material in the membrane. So in the membrane, we'll be having lipid layer, as we discussed in the previous class about cell membrane discussion. So the same thing here. Once the drug is getting partitioned into the membrane, it dissolves in the liquid material in the membrane. And during come crossing the membrane, it dissolves again in the aqueous environment inside the cell. So the drug will be in aqueous environment outside the cell, and during crossing the membrane, it will be dissolving in the lipid membrane. And once it comes again outside inside the cell, there again it gets dissolved in the aqueous environment. So that is what we say about the partition coefficient or lipophilic hydrophilic balance. So a drug should possess both lipophilicity and hydrophilicity for better dissolution as well as permeation. This is what about the passive diffusion is. So it's a energy free process. So kinetic energy of the molecule, every molecule has its own kinetic energy. So that kinetic energy of the molecule is the act as a driving force. So no any other extra additional energy will be involved in this passive diffusion. Well, so hope you got an outline about passive diffusion. Let's discuss about the law which governs in the passive diffusion in the next slide. So let's discuss about passive diffusion. So here in this passive diffusion, in a continuation, we are going to discuss about the Fick's law. So the passive diffusion is best expressed by Fick's first law. So that majorly states the drug molecule diffuses from a region of higher concentration to one of the lower concentration until the equilibrium is attained, and that the rate of diffusion is directly proportional to the concentration gradient across the membrane. So as we said, the concentration gradient plays a major factor, and that can be described with the help of an equation as follows. So dq by dt is equal to d a k m by w by h, which is multiplied with concentration of GIT minus concentration is plasma. So let us know what is it one by one. dq by dt is nothing but the rate of drug diffusion, where d is diffusion coefficient of the drug, and a is the surface area of the absorption membrane, and km by w is nothing but the partition coefficient of the drug between membrane and aqueous phase, and CGIT minus C is nothing but the difference in concentration of drug in GI fluid and the plasma, and H is about thickness of the membrane. So this is the equation derives. So let's see what are the various characteristics which is interlinked with this Fick's law in the next slide. So here, based on the equation, certain characteristics are being undergone by the passive diffusion. They are the concentration gradient. So here, it's nothing but a climbing downhill. So concentration gradient plays a major factor, higher concentration to lower concentration. So climbing down a hill, or else going with the flow of water stream. So that is nothing but this concentration gradient is. So this is one thing which is interrelated with the equation. And the rate of drug transfer is proportional to the concentration gradient between the GI fluid and blood. So that's what in the equation, the last part. So that is proportional, directly proportional to it. So the higher the difference, higher will be the diffusion or transportation. So CGIT minus C. That is what the second one. The next is about the surface area as well as the thickness. So H, the term which has been in the equation. So less the thickness, it will be having better
absorption. Also, the surface area, higher the surface area, A, the parameter in the equation, higher the surface area and lesser the thickness, it will be possessing better absorption of drug. And the next is about equilibrium will be attaining upon equal concentration on the both sides. So as we said, initially there will be higher concentration, thereby a bulk flow of drug will be crossing through the membrane without an energy, use of energy to the lower concentration. Upon equal, when this both the place get equal, so this gets stopped and thereby it undergoes a process of equilibrium level, equal among both the sides, and thereby it gets stopped over there. The next is about drug with ionized or unionized. There are some condition that a drug will be in ionized nature or unionized nature. So in such condition, primarily the transferring of unionized drug will be higher in rate, around 3 to 4 times than an ionized drug. So there will be a better movement of unionized drug than an ionized drug. The next is about the membrane or water partition coefficient. So greater the partition coefficient, greater will be the absorption. And the last is about dilution of the GI fluid. So this is one approach which has been utilized in case of overdosing or poisoning. So once a drug has been given in overdose, so we have to stop its absorption. So in such condition, we can go for diluting the GI fluid. So as it is getting diluted, the concentration of the overdose drug or the poisonous drug will be getting low. So as it gets low, the drug transportation will be stopped because here the concentration got minimized. So this is one approach where the passive diffusion can be utilized. Well, let's move on to the next slide. So here the passive diffusion is energy independent and non-saturable, but here the molecular weight matters a lot. So it depends on the square root of molecular weight of a drug. So a drug whose molecular weight is 100 to 400 Dalton will be a suitable size to get transport. Similarly, increase in molecular weight will be affecting the diffusion. So when the molecular weight is getting gradually increasing from 100 to 400, there will be a significant difference in diffusion rate also. The next is about the maintenance of sink condition. So what is this maintenance of sink condition? So upon passive absorption of drug, it enters into the blood by distributing it into the blood fluid. So therefore, this process upon concentration of drug at absorption site will be higher, that is in the GIT will be higher than the concentration in the plasma. So that particular condition is called as a sink condition, and this passive diffusion undergo first order kinetics. So that can be derived by an equation which is substitution of the dA and the partition coefficient and thickness as a P, because of these remains constant in some particular conditions. So as it is remaining constant, we make that as a representation of P, permeability constant, and therefore the previous equation of fixed law can be minimized as Q by dQ by dt is equal to P concentration of GIT. So this is one which is possible where the drug undergo first order kinetics. Let's move on to the next slide. So pore transport. Pore transportation, it is also called as connective convective transport, bulk transport, or filtration. So here it undergoes the transportation of drug by the driving force of hydrostatic pressure or osmotic difference for transporting across the membrane. So using of hydrostatic pressure or osmotic pressure as a driving force with water flux for transportation of drug, that can be called as a solvent drag. So that is due to the bulk movement of water, that some drugs will be getting transported along with that. So that we call it as a solvent drag. So other criteria for prototransportation are, the drug should have low molecular weight, less than 100. So in previous case we have discussed about the molecular weight of 100 to 400, but here the molecular weight should be less than 100. So generally water soluble drugs that can easily pass through this narrow aqueous filled channels due to the low molecular weight also, and some water soluble drugs also can move through these channels, such as urea, water, sugar, and some other conditions where a drug is having higher molecular weight than 100. So in such condition, only if it is a chain like or a linear compound, it can absorb through the process of filtration, such as alkanes. So a lengthy chain of material or molecule whose weight is around 400 Dalton also can be crossed only if it is a linear compound. So this is what the condition which comes under the pore transportation is of. And finally, as I said in the second point, so solvent drag, so water fill channel will be using in various parameters such as renal excretion and removal of drug from the cerebrospinal fluid and enter of drug into the liver. So this is the another condition where the pore transportation is utilized of. Well, let's move on to the next slide. Ion pair transport. So saying about ion pair transport, here the drugs like quaternium compounds such as benzalkonium chloride, benzethonium chloride and sulfonic acids are some drugs which ionizes at all pH. These undergo this ion pair transport. So this is possible by forming a reversible neutral complex. So the drug will be binding with the endogenous ions of gastrointestinal tract such as mucin, and it forms a reverse neutral complex. So this reverse neutral complex have enough lipophilicity as well as hydrophilicity, thereby it supports for passive diffusion of drug through the membrane. So that neutral complex which moves through this process, we call it as a ion pair transportation. Well, let's know what is it by diagrammatic form in the next slide. So here a drug which is ionic in nature, it cannot penetrate through the membrane as easier, so it should form some complex. So from a drug movement from gastrointestinal lumen to the blood, which is ionic in nature, should form a complex. That's what we are going to see now. A cationic drug will form a complex with some endogenous anion, and this complex is nothing but a neutral ion pair complex. So this neutral ion pair complex have a tendency to get passively diffused through the membrane into the bloodstream. So once it reaches the bloodstream, there it undergoes the dissociation of the complex into a free drug as well as the endogenous anion. So thereby the cationic drug get easily penetrate through the membrane and gets distributed to the blood. So hope you got understood about this concept of ion pair transportation. And here some other examples what we can say is propanol. So this propanol is a basic drug. It forms an ion pair with oleic acid, and through that it get transport through the membranes. This is another example of this condition. But let's move on to the next slide. So the next is about carrier mediated transport. So carrier mediated transport, here some polar drug will be crossing the membrane more readily and can be predicted their movement by concentration gradient and partition coefficient value, such as monosaccharides, amino acids and vitamins. So these are some poorly absorbed drug molecules. The mechanism involved in this carrier mediated is the binding of drug reversibly or non-covalently with solute molecule to be transported. And this carrier solute complex will form a transverse across the membrane to the other side, where it dissociates and discharges the solute molecule. So here in this carrier mediated, a reversible or a non-covalent binding with a solute will be taking place, that will form a carrier solute complex, and this carrier solute complex will be traveling across the membrane. And once it travels from one side of the membrane to other side of the membrane, it dissociates and it discharges the solute. The carrier dissociates and it discharges the solute inside the cell. So once it releases inside the cell, this carrier will be again getting returning back to its original position. So it will return back to its original position for accepting the next fresh molecule. So that is what a carrier mediated transportation is of. So this carrier mediated transportation might be taken place through transport proteins and may be by enzymes or some other components of the membrane. But let's move on to the next slide. So what are the important characteristics which is related to the carrier mediated transporters? So the first is, this carrier mediated transportation is a structure specific. So the receptors which is responsible for binding to a particular drug which is fitting to its carrier only can bind and get transported. So it won't bind with all type of drugs. So drug which is suitable to the specific receptor, it will bind and that complex will be getting transported and the drug will be crossing the membrane, releasing to the other end of the membrane. And there are some conditions where drugs will be having similar structure to that of the essential nutrients. So this process is predominant for carrying out the nutrients also. So some drugs which have the same structure of the nutrients or similar structure of the nutrients will be easily undergoing this process of transportation, that we call it as a false nutrients. Example is 5-fluorouracil or 5-bromouracil. So this is one criteria. The next is about competitive binding. So as the carrier are limited in numbers, so when two similar structure of compounds meeting each other to the binding site, so the higher affinity drug will get binded. So that we call it as a competitive binding. And the next thing is about capacity limited. As I said in the previous point, based on the availability only, the drug transportation will be take place. Based on the availability of the carrier. So if the carrier is less, the binding tendency also will be lesser, the movement also will be lesser. So the drug will be free in the lumen until the availability of the next carrier. So it is capacity limited, whereas in case of passive, it will be moving based on the concentration gradient. So there won't be any saturation. Based upon the concentration gradient, there will be uniform flow. So if you are plotting a graph of carrier mediated transport along with the passive transport, we will be getting a linear line in passive transport, whereas in carrier mediated, initially when there is free carriers, the binding will be there and the movement of drug will be faster. Once the all the carrier has been got engaged with the molecule of drug, then it leads to a saturation of drug in the lumen, and it will form a small plateau until the carriers are getting free. So in case of passive, we'll get a linear line. So as goes on time, the release of the permeation also will be higher in passive, but in carrier, based on the availability of the carrier, it varies. So the graph gets plateau at a particular level in case of carrier mediated transportation. The next is about interlinked to the previous point, the graph. As I said, there will be proportionate increase for a particular time, and at one stage it undergo a plateau level. So here it undergoes a mixed order kinetics. It follows a first order for a few while and a zero order for a while. So there is a mixed order condition. So this carrier mediated transport undergoes mixed order kinetics, and this says that the mixed order kinetics is nothing but Michaelis-Menten or saturation kinetics or non-linear kinetics. So this carrier mediated transport undergoes Michaelis-Menten, saturation kinetics or non-linear kinetics. The next one is about the bioavailability of the drug decreases with increase in dose. So decreases with increase in dose, in the sense, so some drugs such as vitamin B1, B2, B12. So the bioavailability of the drug absorbed will be reducing with increasing doses, mainly because of the binding tendency of the carrier being saturated. So upon repeated administration of vitamin B1 or B2 or B12, it gets saturate the carrier proteins which is available in the membrane. Thereby it get stops and bioavailability will be getting reduced on repeated administration. So it is called as the process in where we have to monitor the administration of vitamins based upon the availability of the carrier. The next is about the absorption window. So what do you mean by absorption window? So some specific absorption or carrier mediator absorption will be taking place in the intestine. How does it? In intestine, some particular space may have a dense of carrier system. Huge amount of carrier system may be available at a specific site in intestine. So that place we call it as an absorption window. So here enough amount of absorption will be taking place. So this is what another thing called as carrier mediated transport characteristics. So well, let's move on to the next slide. So in this carrier mediated transport, we have two types of carrier mediated transport. One is facilitated diffusion, another is active transport. So in case of the first one, facilitated diffusion, here it is a carrier mediated transport system that operates down the concentration gradient, but at much faster rate than the simple passive diffusion. So here also it undergo passive diffusion process, but having this concentration gradient as a parameter, but the movement will be much better or higher than that of the simple passive diffusion. And here the driving force is concentration gradient, hence it is a passive process. And some examples which we can say for this is glucose which is getting entered into RBCs, or else then some other examples are the intestinal absorption of vitamin B1, B2. And here the transportation mainly takes place, that we can explain with the help of an example. The intrinsic factor which has been present in the vital cells of gastric, so this will be binding with the vitamin B12. So vitamin B12 complex will be forming with the intrinsic factor. So this intrinsic factor is a glycoprotein. So this glycoprotein has been mainly synthesized or produced in parietal cells of gastric area. So upon taking or administering a vitamin B12 drug, so it will be forming a complex with the intrinsic factor. So that intrinsic factor will be supporting it to get facilitated diffusion through the membrane. So as far as we discussed in the previous ion pair complex, a neutral pair will be formed between cationic drug as well as the endogenous anion. Similarly, here a complex has been formed. So it is not an ionic complex, but it is a complex of drug with the enzyme which has been present in the gastric area. So that will be supporting for better penetration, facilitated diffusion is. So that is what one example which comes under this here process. So here in facilitated diffusion, the absorption will be faster than the elimination or diffusion. So diffusion process, as we said in the first slide. So better diffusion will be that than that of the sample diffusions here. So the last one about it and related to the carrier mediated risk in this slide is, so no energy has been required, so the process is inhibited by metabolic plasma poison that interferes with the energy production. So no any energy is used, but sometime due to some metabolic poison it may get inhibited. It's more than that. So active process, the next one is about. So the main important thing here, we utilize an energy, ATP. So the active transport mechanism are mainly used. So this is further subdivided into a primary active transport and secondary active transport. So the primary active transport is, in this process there is a direct ATP requirement. Moreover, the process transfer only ions or molecules and in only one direction, hence we call it as an uniporter. Example, absorption of glucose. And the next is secondary active transport. In this process there is no direction requirement of ATP, that is it takes advantage of previously existing concentration gradient. So the energy required is transporting an ion, a transport of another ion or a molecule, either in same direction or in opposite direction. So we call it as co-transportation or coupled transportation. So same or opposite direction it takes place. So this is one which comes under the active transporters. So coming to an important concept in active transport, here the drug will be moving from lower concentration to higher concentration. So far we have been discussing about the movement of drug from higher concentration to lower concentration, but in active transport the drug will be moving from lower concentration to the higher concentration. So energy, ATP, will be utilized. So this energy will be used for climbing up the hill concept or driving against the stream of water. So that is what. So here the concept of equilibrium is not an important condition, whereas in concentration gradient that equilibrium is an important, but here it doesn't works out. And some compounds which undergoes this active transportation are sodium, potassium, calcium, iron, glucose, amino acids, niacin and pyridoxine, ascorbic acid. So these are the some compounds which generally undergoes active transportation between the membranes. So drugs which is having similar structures also undergo this process. But let's move on to the next slide. So active transportation, so according to the process, it is further subdivided into symport or antiport. So co-transportation, the in case of symport it involves movement of both the molecule in same direction. Example is sodium glucose importer. And in antiport it involves movement of molecule in opposite direction. Example, H plus ion using the sodium gradient in the kidney. Well, next, move to the next slide. So this is an example of movement of drug in antiport and symport. So in the first image, in antiport So a molecule will be coming from one area, it will be binding and it will be moving to the next, whereas here in syncope it will be moving in the same direction. So this is what both needs energy for movement of molecules, as ATP as an energy is utilized here. So that is what this import is of. Well, regarding the syncope and antiquote, let's and whatever this topic we discussed so far, let's have a video thing which I have been taken from my YouTube, so that will be easy understanding for the learners all these concepts. So let's continue with the video.
Carrier mediated transport. The characteristics of carrier mediated transport are stereospecificity of carrier proteins. The carrier protein recognizes only one isomer of a substance. Competition for carrier binding sites. Substances that have similar structures compete to bind to the carrier protein. Saturation with carrier proteins. Transport maximum occurs when all the transport binding sites for a particular substance are occupied. Due to this, the substance cannot bind to its carrier and therefore it does not pass through the membrane. Facilitated transport. This does not require metabolic energy and occurs down an electrochemical gradient. The transport stops when the carrier molecules become saturated or when the concentration of the substance inside the cell becomes equal to the extracellular concentration. Active transport. It is the transport of a substance against its electrochemical gradient. Hydrolysis of ATP is required to power this process. Primary active transport. It is the transport of a substance across the cell membrane which is directly coupled to ATP hydrolysis. Examples are sodium potassium ATPase pump in the cell membrane, which pumps 2 potassium inside the cell and 3 sodium outside the cell for each ATP consumed, and calcium ATPase pump in the muscle cells, which removes calcium from the cell into the extracellular space at the expense of ATP hydrolysis during muscle relaxation. Secondary active transport. Movement of 2 substances across the plasma membrane simultaneously, which is indirectly coupled to ATP hydrolysis. Symport, also known as co-transport. Both substances move in the same direction, for example, sodium and glucose in the proximal tubule of the kidney. Antiport, also known as counter-transport. Both substances move in opposite directions. For example, in the heart muscle cells, the sodium and calcium counter-transporter moves calcium against its concentration gradient as sodium moves down its concentration gradient.
So paracellular or intracellular transport. So in the previous, so far you have seen some videos about the various active and passive transportation, all these things. And here we are going to see about the next one, paracellular or intracellular transportation. So it is defined as the transportation of drug through the junctions between the gastrointestinal epithelial cells. So this pathway is of minor importance in drug absorption. Also, the 2 paracellular transport mechanism involved in drug absorption are permeation through tight junctions of epithelial cells. So this process basically occurs through opening which are light bigger than the aqueous pores. So compounds such as insulin, cardiac glycosides are taken up with this mechanism. And persorption is the next one. Here, the permeation of drug through temporary opening formed by shielding of 2 neighbor epithelial cells into the lumen. So that is what about pore sorption is. So here the permeation takes place by temporary opening between the two neighboring epithelial cells. So let's move on to the next.
Particles or macromolecules that are too large and too charged or polar to pass through biological membranes are taken into cells by a process called endocytosis. Phagocytosis is one of three types of endocytosis. In phagocytosis, which means cellular eating, part of the plasma membrane engulfs the particle. Unicellular protists use phagocytosis for feeding, and some white blood cells use it for defending the body, engulfing foreign cells or substances. The resulting vesicle, called a phagosome, fuses with a lysosome, and the contents are digested. In another type of endocytosis called pinocytosis, small vesicles pinch off from the plasma membrane, bringing small dissolved substances or fluids into the cell. Pinocytosis means cellular drinking. A type of endocytosis called receptor-mediated endocytosis is used by animal cells to capture specific macromolecules from the cell's environment. For example, most mammalian cells use this method to take up cholesterol packaged in low-density lipoprotein particles. The cell uses receptors that specifically recognize and bind to the LDL particle. The receptors are clustered together in a reinforced membrane structure called a coated pit. An LDL particle contains 1,000 or more cholesterol molecules at its core. A monolayer of phospholipids surrounds the cholesterol core and is embedded with proteins called ApoB. These ApoB proteins are specifically recognized by the receptors in the cell's membrane. The receptors in the coated pit bind to the ApoB proteins on the LDL particle. The pit is reinforced by a lattice-like network of proteins called clathrin. Additional clathrin molecules then add to the lattice, which eventually pinches off a part of the membrane with the attached LDL particle inside. Inside the cell, the vesicle soon becomes uncoated as the clathrin molecules dissociate from the vesicle and from each other. Although not shown here, another vesicle then fuses with the LDL-containing vesicle, causing the pH inside to drop and forcing the receptors to dissociate from the LDL particle. After the receptors are released from the LDL particle, the vesicle fuses with a lysosome. A lysosome carries enzymes capable of digesting the LDL particle into amino acids and fatty acids. At the same time, the cholesterol is released into the cytoplasm. The cell either uses the cholesterol immediately or stores it for later. Meanwhile, the cell's LDL receptors are returned to the plasma membrane. Once in the plasma membrane, they can take in more LDL particles by receptor-mediated endocytosis. In contrast to endocytosis, exocytosis is the process by which a variety of substances leave the cell. For example, newly made proteins destined for secretion are packaged into vesicles inside the cell and transported to the plasma membrane. The vesicle membrane and plasma membrane fuse together. The contents of the vesicle spill outside the cell, while the vesicle membrane is smoothly incorporated into the plasma membrane.
Well, hope you all understood this concept about mechanism of absorption, and hope the video might be useful for you to understand about the information. So any doubts, you can please feel free to ask me regarding this presentation. So in the next class, we'll be discussing about the factors influencing the drug absorption in the gastrointestinal tract. So hope you all understood. And thank you all for your valuable time. And as common, always do better, good aspects, think good, do good, behave good, and as a karma, you will receive good. Thank you all.